Hi, my name's Joe Vaccaro Jr., driver of the Mary Six-Pack of More sponsored number 53 Speedster.
And my name is Joey Vaccaro, driver of the Mary Six-Pack and More sponsored number 53 Slingshot.
After a long day of work, working at home, or as for us, working on your race cars, there's no better place to stop by than Mary Six-Pack and More for all your adult beverage needs. Mary Six-Pack has over 3,000 different beers in stock and offers a 20% discount on mixed six-packs. Mary's also has 14 different beers on tap and offers complete growler service for your fresh beer needs. Also come in on Sundays for some bench racing with thy bartender, Diane Tobias.
Once again, for all your adult beverage needs, come to Mary Six Pack and More, 835 Easter Lanes, Reading, PA. Good evening. Welcome to the November edition of Strapped In. I'm your host, Mike Feltenberger, and tonight we're going to be talking sprint car racing with the 2015 National Sprint Car Hall of Fame enshrinee, Don Kreitz, Jr. We got plenty of questions to get to. Home viewer line, 610-378-0426. Upcoming events, and I have one on the schedule. Next weekend, December 9th and 10th, at the Trenton Sunbank Center, they're going to have the TQs, the go-karts, and the slingshots. It's an indoor race down at the Sunbank Center down in Trenton. They have some great action down there. It's close, it's competitive, and if you're a fan that likes to see a lot of accidents, then head on down because you're going to have plenty of them to watch down at the Sunbank Center down in Trenton. Got special questions here for Don. I'd like to get to them right away. Like I said, home viewer line 610-378-0426. Don, was your learning curve harder as a rookie driver in the modifieds or when you decided to become a sprint car driver?
I would say harder in the modifieds because I never raced anything before I started running modified. So, started out at Grandview and Big Diamond, and, you know, it was tough there, a lot of beating and banging. So, you know, by the time I got into sprint cars, I had already had, 5 years, call it racing experience. So it did go a little bit smoother.
Okay, now with that, did you use one of your dad's cars or was this something that he built especially for you when you started racing?
No, he had an old frame out behind the shop that was bent up and repaired many times. And he said, if you want to race, you know, I'll guide you and answer your questions, but I'm not going to do the work for you or, you know, pay for it. You're going to have to do it yourself. So he said, there's enough stuff out here in our scrap. You can probably just about get a car together. So, you know, we took old transmission and fixed them up and made one, and old rears and straightened them and made one, and same with the frame. And that's how we started out.
Okay, your dad had a Valiant when he was racing, which was pretty popular, along with the coupe and the coach. And you were in a Gremlin. Was that a decision that you made to put a Gremlin body on, or was that just something that was still sitting around in the shop somewhere?
It was kind of just the way the sport was transitioning at the time. Guys had started from, let's just say, the junkyard bodies, which was the coupes and coaches, and my dad had a Valiant, and starting to the handmade bodies like they have nowadays, fabricated. And when I was starting out, that's how it was. So, you know, I could make my own body by myself, you know, just pay for the sheet metal. So that's why we went that way.
Okay, then when you moved into the sprint cars, did your dad or you design a sprint car chassis out of your shop, or did you get something from somebody else?
We actually bought one. It was a Nance chassis. They're no longer in business, but at the time they were a very popular sprint car, and we didn't have a jig for the sprint cars, and they're a little bit more temperamental to build than, say, a modified, and so we decided to buy one.
Okay, this past weekend you had your Kreitz annual flea market, right?
Yes.
And how many years has this been going on?
You know what? It started the year after Reading closed, so somewhere, I'm going to say around 1980. I think 79, maybe Reading, I don't know, they either had one in 78 or 79, and then we kind of took over the flea market thing, you know, from them and had it at our business. A lot of guys wanted us to have one, had stuff to sell, and so since 79 or 80 every year.
Okay, with that being said, do you put your stuff out on the flea market too?
Absolutely.
Really?
Yep. Wow. Every year. That's why we started having it. It was free for guys to come. We never charged anyone. They could come and guys would sell their stuff. And, it ends up being, I don't know what you call it, bench racing. Also, a lot of people come together. Sprint cars, modifieds, there's go-karts there, late models, just about anything.
Okay, with that, are you seeing an increase in the vendors and the buyers, or you said you had a pretty well-attended event? You actually feel that people are actually putting this on their schedule now at the beginning of the year to attend your flea market at the end of the year?
They do, but I would still say the trend, there's probably more buyers coming, but maybe less sellers than there was originally, or let's just say through the 80s and 90s, because a lot of the, let's just say the younger generation, maybe they don't want to, mess with that too much, right? Do the work and come out, where the older guys, that's all they knew, right? Because they used to go to the junkyard and such, so for them to gather their stuff up and come to a flea market, it's nothing for them. So I'd say eventually it will probably phase out, but we still have a good following of it.
Okay, that going there, you had a fantastic career. You're a member of the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame. What was the major reason, Don, that you decided to hang up the racing helmet?
I had been having concussion symptoms, dizziness, headaches, balance problems, and I was going from doctor to doctor until they finally figured it out. I got a good neurologist and said, I had, for some reason, just from either racing over the years. I did have a concussion in 2013 at Susquehanna at their last race at the end of the year, but didn't really have any since then. But I guess just from racing and my head shaking around after having that initial concussion, made it like I had a whole pile of small concussions. Right. And, I wasn't really able to race anymore, so we kind of had to hang it up whether we wanted to or not.
So then Earnhardt Jr.'s decision not to race with his concussion syndromes actually was done health-wise for the drivers that he's racing against and also himself?
Yes, that is correct, because you're just not as sharp. Everything moves slower, and again, you don't have your balance, and naturally in racing you need, quick reflexes, have to make quick decisions, and if you're a little slow upstairs, you just can't do it, especially, well, in any form of racing, but certainly not in a 410 sprint car.
Okay, Randy.
There's a lot of emphasis by the sprint car teams nowadays on the time trial shows. Is that because of the payout, or is it just a better format, or what's the main, like, your guys do it, Raymer's does it, that's become the thing now to run the time trial shows mostly instead of the regular shows?
Probably a little bit of both, but mainly because of the payout. I mean, naturally, if the regular shows would be the highest paying shows, we would run them.
Oh,
but
okay.
Yeah, the time trial shows, which probably was originally started by, I shouldn't even say the Outlaws, I guess, way back in the Reading days, I think, when USAC would come into town and stuff, they'd time trial. So time trial shows were always the big shows, it just seemed like in racing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Has the recent takeover of Susquehanna added any new interest for the 410 sprint teams?
I would say, yeah, they're doing a really good job there. Naturally, they really sunk a lot of money into it, fixing it up, and, give us good track conditions and a nice little schedule there. So it's definitely drawn a lot of interest.
Okay, home viewer line 610-378-0426. You were quite successful at Susky. Was there any particular reason why?
I always adapted to it. Even back, and I'm sure you guys remember when they ran modifieds there. I won there in small block modifieds when they'd run them there weekly. I don't know why. I always ran good myself on tracks that would widen out to 3-4 lanes where you could kind of race anywhere, top, middle, or bottom, you know, if you needed to, even though I was known for running the bottom. Still, if you had to go around a guy, there was plenty of room, plenty of racing groove. So, and that track's always been real racy in modifieds and in sprint cars, so it just always took a liking to it.
Okay. In your opinion, was Dan Dietrich's move at that race there, was that justified? When he parked the car in the front straightaway and just...
I'm sure he had his reasons. I don't know. I might have done that at some point when I was younger in my career. If I think back, you know, if you think you were wronged, but I, you know, in that case, I don't really know that he had a leg to stand on. And yeah, he just ended up making it worse for himself.
Okay, now, how were you informed that you were going to become a member of the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame? Was it an email, a phone call, a letter? How did you find out, Don?
They actually call you. The guy that's in charge of the Hall of Fame out there, Bob Baker's his name. He called, and I'm halfway thinking it was like Christmas Eve or something. It was somewhere around there. He called the parts store, and... he said, hey, I got some good news for you. You know, you're going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. And he said, the only thing is, he said, you can't tell anyone. He said, you know, if you want to tell your wife or, you know, your wife and daughter, but no one can tell anyone because they like to, they have a big deal. They make an announcement out at Chili Bowl every year in January. So they don't like it to get out before then who's going to be inducted into it.
How long does that take to sink in, though, when somebody calls you and says you're in the Hall of Fame? I mean, when you started, did you ever even think that far ahead that you'd be doing something like that?
No, you never, you know, you can't think that far ahead. Certainly, you know, you think of that stuff more as you wind down, mm-hmm. you know, in your career. So it was, you know, and it worked out well for me, you know, since I ended up stopping then not long after that. But it's certainly a good accomplishment, something we're proud of.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's talk about your business. It's Kreitz Oval Track Racing Parts, right?
Kreitz Oval Track Parts.
And it's on the Fritzstown Road?
In Sinking Spring.
Okay, now we have drivers of many classes that watch the show, Don. Can you let everybody know, does your actual business encompass everything from small cars to big cars, or do you sort of accentuate a type of class compared to another?
Probably concentrating mostly on sprint car parts. But naturally we do sell, you know, racing uniforms, suits, shields for helmets, tear-offs, things that you can use in any class of racing we do have there. But as far as all the parts that are needed on the car, mainly sprint car parts.
Okay, with that, there's a lot of emphasis from the insurance companies to the racetracks about head and neck safety devices. Do you sell Hans devices or anything equivalent at the sprint
yes,
show?
Yes, we do sell head and neck devices.
Now, do they have different ones to pick from, because they said there's like a heavier Hans device, there's a lightweight one, is there any that they can choose from?
We keep one that is supposed to be better for, actually that was supposed to be the best for open wheel,
okay,
you know, sprint cars and modifieds, let's just call it.
Okay, do you and former teammate Ryan Smith still communicate?
Yep, he comes in the parts store, they buy parts from us, and we talk every now and then.
Does he park aside at the racetrack or any? Or?
No, I can't really say we do that. You know, we really only go to, Williams Grove most of the time in Susquehanna. Williams Grove, we, you know, park in the same spot all the time, and, you know, so yeah, Ryan doesn't usually park in the spot aside
did
of us.
Did you congratulate him when he won his feature? Were you there?
Yeah. I wasn't there at his Outlaw race he won at Port Royal,
okay.
But I did.
The Williams Grove.
I sent him a text.
Okay.
Okay. You've been known in your racing career to be one of the low groove runners. What part of the race, or when into the race, Don, do you realize that the low groove isn't the fast groove anymore? Can you pick it out right away when you're on a racetrack?
one guy's past you. Yeah. Then you know, one guy goes by, and then you're still trying to get by him. Then, you know, either you see the nose of another guy or another guy goes past you. You know, you know either that. You know, a lot of times as you race a long time, as you get experience, you know, you can kind of read the track. You get a feel for it. You usually have to, move around a little bit.
Okay, when you're up running the top, can you sense somebody's going to pull a slide job on you?
Sometimes you can if you know someone's back there. Sometimes it's too late. There's nothing, like, sometimes it really catches you off guard and you have no idea. Sometimes you have a sense, you know, you can kind of tell if you're getting off the corner good and then going down the straightaway and you know that someone's not on you, or opposite, if you're not getting off the corner real good and you think, you know what, someone might be coming, you know, it might be a slide job coming.
Okay. Randy?
I guess we can ask you, like, when you started, you ran modifieds at Reading, and then you went to Penn National, Big Diamond, Grandview, and from there you went into sprint cars. Was that planned at all to run sprint cars? Did you have that in your goal, in your mind at all, or were you going to run modifieds for your career?
I never did. Yeah, we were going to run modifieds for our whole career. So naturally, the first kink in that armor was when Reading closed. Mm-hmm. You know, we were close to Reading.
Oh yeah.
My father always ran Reading. That was our home track. Mm-hmm. So after that closed, that was the first thing. And then so now we had to travel, you know, to go racing. And Dave Kelly, and he always ran our frames that we built cars in, the modifieds, mm-hmm. and he always ran them, and he was starting to dabble in the URC, and the sprint cars would run at modified tracks. So he'd hop in a car every now and then in someone's car, then he eventually got one, and he said, hey, you should take a look at these things. The sprint cars, they're a lot more fun to run than the modifieds, you know.
And they kind of sell Fitzcharles on them too?
And I don't know if... I have to think about that, but I'm thinking Glenn started after me. I don't know when he...
These are all right around that same
time. I think I was, when I went into URC, you know, Dave Kelly was there, like a modified drivers. Kevin Collins was there. Yeah. I don't think Glenn was there. I think he came in at least maybe a year or two later, but I'm not real sure. Somewhere close to the same time, though.
He saw the fun you guys were having.
Yeah, right, yep.
Okay, was there ever a track you decided you would never race at again?
I don't know. I didn't really want to run Syracuse in a sprint car. You know, I was there one time for that, and, you know, it wasn't that bad in a modified, though, but not really in a sprint car. I don't think so. I didn't ever really, I mean, yeah, you get that if you think you got a roll deal on something, you know, you might say, I'm never going back there to a certain track, but not really for me.
Okay. Is there a tire rule in sprint cars in Central Pennsylvania?
Yes. Yes. Everyone has to run the same tire, and on our weekly shows, you have to run, well, no, you don't have to run the same tire. I don't even think they do that on the weekly shows anymore. We only ran the bigger shows, but sometimes you can change tires all night. Sometimes, like when the Outlaws are in, whatever tire your time trial on, you have to run in the heat race and in the dash if you're in it. Then you can put a new tire on for the feature. You know, they just do that to save costs, basically, from putting a new tire on every time you're on the track.
Do you have a home track right now with sprint cars, or you just pick and choose shows?
Oh, I guess it would be Williams Grove. We don't run there every week, though.
We
do run the bigger shows, but I guess that would have to be our home track.
Okay.
Okay, now with you being a part-time race team, are you spending just as many hours in the garage working on a race car as you did when you ran weekly?
Pretty much. You know, back when I ran weekly in the 80s and 90s, you know, there was actually a little bit more racing than there is now. It was every single Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. But as far as, you know, with the guys running now, it's basically just a Friday, Saturday, and then special shows. You know, we still work every night on the car. So there's, you know, it takes a lot of work, especially if you want to, you know, try and run up front.
Would you like to see Susquehanna go back to Thursday nights running sprint cars like they were before? You like that part at all? Was that good?
It didn't really matter to me. I mean, it was nice, and it probably is nicer for the racers to run on a Thursday, say instead of a Sunday. You know, because then even for us, if we run Thursday and Friday, you kind of still have your weekend.
Right,
you
right.
know,
mm-hmm.
going Sunday nights is tough. Now they usually do get it over early. But, you know, it is tough. I mean, we work Mondays like most guys do. All my mm-hmm. guys on the car work, you know, they all have jobs, they work. So it is certainly tougher going on a Sunday night.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now this is a question I should ask a little earlier. When you were elected and enshrined into the Hall of Fame, did you get any congratulatory messages from somebody you never would have expected to get it from?
I don't think so. I mean, I got a lot. I can't even, you know, trying to remember, you know, all of them. I did get a lot, but I don't think there was any really, you know, unexpected, just say from like a famous race car driver or something, you know, because they pretty much need to have your number.
Okay. Now, here we go. I'm going to answer. We're going to ask a question. I got over 20 emails. The same question. Here we go. You hired Lance DeWeese as your driver. How did this union happen? And if so, is he coming back for the 2017 season?
Lance actually called me at the end of last racing season, November, December, somewhere around there, and just said, you know, would you be interested and having me drive the car, and we get together and talk about it. And you know, naturally I said, you know, that I would be. I didn't know what his deal was up to that point. He had always, you know, ran a lot of races,
right.
Ran all the races you could run basically, and I knew we were only going to run around, you know, 20 some races, and I didn't think that would suit his schedule. But you know, he said he kind of wanted to slow down, and That was fine to him, and you know, naturally it worked out very well. And yes, we did talk, and he is coming back for next year, him and Davey Brown, so we're gonna try it again.
Well, I can cross that Davey Brown question off now.
The same basic schedule, same deal.
Basic same. We had 28 races on the schedule this year,
mm-hmm.
and you know, rainouts and stuff. I don't know. We ended up running 24, 25, something like that.
Okay, with Davey Brown coming back, how long has he been with your team, Don?
This last stint, he's been with me full-time. Well, I say full-time. He just comes to the races, doesn't come to the shop or anything. But since 99, straight through. Before that, you know, on and off in the late 80s through the 90s when he wasn't helping anyone else.
Right.
But he's been with me solid since 99.
Yeah, I remember him at the fairgrounds when he was with Tobias. And he'd stand at the fence and just listen to the car go by. And he'd just stand there. And then he'd walk over to Toby's car and just twist and turn. Next thing you know, Toby's out there winning the race. And it's like, what the heck happened? You know, and Davey was just amazing.
Yeah, he's definitely one of a kind.
And he said at Susquehanna, I think it's, what, 62 years he's been doing this now?
Yeah.
That's a long time.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Now, with Lance as the driver, did he suggest any different chassis, or everything was going to be based on your career, your race team, and what you were going to put on the speedway for him?
He actually said, let's just do everything how we were doing it. You know, when I was driving the car, I said, I think we should just start out there. And, you know, we didn't end up changing that much. He kind of adapted to the car right away, and you know, I knew he would with his driving style. I mean, obviously he's very capable and can run anywhere on the track, high or low or middle, can run on a wet track, a dry track. So, he just adapted to the car right away.
Okay, one more.
Did he suggest shows to you that weren't on your schedule that he wanted to run, like say Port Royal more often or maybe an all-star race or something? Did he want to go somewhere that you really didn't have on your schedule?
He was very easy to work with on everything. I said to him, he said, hey, can you make up a schedule? You know, he said that way, you know, if we're not going to race, maybe I'll plan a vacation or something like that. So I know what's going on. And I made up a schedule and I mentioned that to him. You know, I said, if there's a track you like to run or some show you want to go to that's not on the schedule, you know, just let me know. And naturally, we talked during the season too, because it changed a little bit. We ended up running more Speed Week shows than we had on the schedule, because we were going good, you know. So we ended up doing that. But he was very easy to work with. We pretty much stayed right by the schedule.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And with that being said, we're going to go to a couple pictures. We're really going to bring some memories back with a couple of these. Was that your first? That was at Penn National, so that couldn't have been your first.
No, that wasn't the first.
Was that still one of your dad's design race cars?
Yeah. That's all I ever drove was, a frame that he designed, or at one time it was him and Kenny Brightbill designed frames. That's the only thing I've ever driven.
But when you came to Reading, you were basically a teenager, a raw rookie. And you were just good right out of the box.
I don't know about that.
I mean, the guys you ran against, though, you were really competitive with them, you know.
Yeah, it was back then. It was, you know, now it's normal for a driver to start out young.
Well, now they have better equipment than they did back then.
Well, you're right. But I remember when I started out, you know, a lot of the, call it veteran drivers or whatever, was questioning my father. You know, what are you doing sticking your kid in a car at 16, you know? Yeah, and again, because I never had driven anything, you know, go-karts even or anything. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't as much. I mean, there was go-karts back then, but I don't even know, like, micro sprints. You know, there wasn't near as much lower
a lot more
divisions
nowadays,
to choose from as there is right, you know, now. Mm-hmm. So it was not totally unheard of, but kind of. I mean, I was definitely the youngest driver at the track.
Oh, yeah.
For a long time.
Yeah, but like I said, though, when you raced against the guys, you seemed like you were just as experienced. You seemed like you had the, you know, you were very capable right out of the box.
It took a little while. It took maybe half of that first year till we got going, and then, you know, after that it went pretty well.
Okay, now that's taken at Penn National. Now, Penn National and Reading were supposed to be the same style, the same size, but did your driving style have to fluctuate in the different racetrack, those two racetracks, Reading and Penn National?
Yes, it did. I liked Reading too, but I liked Penn National, and, you know, Reading I didn't get to run at a whole lot. Really, that 78 season, which was supposed to be the last, we ran small blocks there. They ran on a Sunday night, small block modifieds, and then in 79 when they ran half a year, we did run in the big blocks there that half a year. And I liked Reading and I liked Penn National, but you did have to drive them different. Penn National, I'm going to say, I think was flatter, you know, and kind of threw the car into the corners more than at Reading, kind of drove it a little bit straighter. But you know, I really, really enjoyed both those tracks.
Okay, next picture, please.
Yeah, the modifieds and like Chamberlain and those guys would go in the corner, they'd throw the rear end around. Now you get into a sprint car, do you have to drive that straighter? Do you change your driving style for that?
You drive it straighter because of the wing on the car.
Okay.
It holds the car, and naturally if you go sideways, you're scrubbing speed off.
Right.
So you want to go as fast as you can, but keep it straight.
Okay.
Okay, I was looking at this picture, and there was a question I had to ask you. Were sneaker? I mean, there's a lot of guys. They either wore the Hush Puppies or the slip-ons and sneakers. Were sneakers? Were they actually comfortable to drive a race car in?
They were. You're very astute on that. My father used Red Wing boots, and then, of course, being a kid, you know, back then, sneakers had a very pliable sole, so you could feel the pedals, you know, real good. So, yeah, I used sneakers. It wasn't long after that when guys did start using racing shoes, but that's right from the very beginning there. That's my first year. And that picture was taken at, you know, one of the first couple of races I was at.
Okay, now, a few drivers actually had superstitions about getting their pictures taken before the race. Did it bother you when somebody came up and said, pose with a card on, or?
No, I just had the normal racing ones, green and no peanuts. that were basically my two that were handed down from my father. But otherwise, no, the picture thing didn't bother me.
Okay, now how long did that car then last after with your first season? Did that carry on in a couple seasons after that, or did you try something different?
I used that the first year, and I don't know if we sold that at the end of the first year or if I kept that and used it some of the second year. I kind of think I only used that car. Of course, it was old when I started with it. And I think I did sell that car the end of that first year. And then I actually used, my father retired halfway through that first year. And then I used his car, the frame that he had been running at the end. I used that my second year.
When you were younger, say 14, 15, before you started racing, did you help your dad in the shop a lot to kind of get used to
it? I did, and I didn't start real early helping him on his car. You know, I did start working, and naturally, I was big mowed the grass for like the whole neighborhood because
money for the race car.
I always wanted to race, and my dad always told me, he said, you know, if you want to race, you got to pay your own way. And you know, till I was 16, I had a pile of money saved up from all these $5 lawn jobs. You know, wow. I'd mow grass every single day, and then I'd work in the shop at night for my father. You know, and yeah, it was, you know, it's just what we had to do to race.
Okay, next picture, please. That's,
I don't know what year that is.
That's long before the adjustable wings, I believe, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out what year. That might be early.
That's not your URC car, is it?
No, that wouldn't have a wing in the front if it was URC.
What does that say on the hood? Does that say Vollmer Patterns? I can't read it.
I believe so, yeah.
That's probably early 90s.
Okay. Now, looking at that, you carried the color tradition on, the Kreitz blue. Did you ever think about changing the number, that separating yourself from your dad, like being a 68 or a 70, or did you just want to keep his number and move it on?
He told me when I got into racing, he said, look, you paint the car, you know, whatever color you want and whatever number. Don't think that you got to do, you know, everything the way I did it. And you know, I wanted to keep it the same. Of course, I didn't think about him, you know, retiring and me carrying it on when we started out. But I'm glad we did over the years.
It says Kreitzer excavating on the hood.
Oh, is it? Okay? So that definitely would be the 90s. That definitely would be in the 90s end. So yeah, no, it's kind of become a tradition, and everyone recognizes the car easily. So I'm glad we did keep it like that.
Why don't you run Lincoln much at all? Is it just you're not
back when I ran Lincoln. I actually have probably more wins than most people would think. There, I did run Lincoln for a couple, 2-3 years.
Oh, okay.
You know, full time. I mean, I started at Sealands Grove when I started running in the 80s. There were three tracks on a Saturday night: Lincoln, Sealands Grove, and Port Royal.
Right, right.
And then, you know, eventually Sealands Grove dropped off. But I actually started running Sealands Grove on Saturdays through the 80s, and then in the 90s, I ran Lincoln. on a Saturday night. I never ran Port Royal Weekly, and I always liked Port Royal. I didn't have anything, you know, I didn't have anything against the track. We had good success whenever we went there, but I didn't really have anything against Lincoln, you know. And later on in my career, when I wasn't really racing full time on Saturday nights, and we just run the big races, you know, Lincoln just didn't. They'd have a couple big races, but mm-hmm. they didn't really have that many. You know, now they started having more of them. So we went there with Lance. You know, this year, first time we were at Lincoln for a long time, but you know, we went back there. It's a nice, you know, racy track, and they take good care of it.
What do you think of the Tuscarora race now, paying $50,000 to win?
Yeah, that's something.
You always have success in. That
yes,
race.
I wish I was still racing, but you know, hopefully we'll get there again next year, and that's something that's good to see. That mm-hmm. that stirs up a lot of interest. Tracks, and I think that's the way it's going. You know, they always get good crowds and good car count naturally at the big races, and I think you're going to see more. You know, more special events, more big races. It just seems to work out well for everyone, for the racers, for the fans,
right?
For the track promoters. You know, so no, that was great. I was so happy to hear that announcement.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you were. At one time, didn't you used to support Bob Miller's Thunder in the Hill shows?
Yes.
And then you sort of cut back from there?
Yes.
Was there a reason for that, or?
Not really. Again, his shows were always midweek, and it just got tough. You know, you have to make decisions. Once we got to where we were, you know, not really a full-time team anymore, you know, you got to make decisions on... You know, on the engines are the most important right. part and most expensive part of sprint car racing, of what races you want to run. Do we want to go run, you know, a Bob Miller show? Or at the time, we were very successful at Susquehanna. Well, no, we're going to skip Grandview, which is kind of a little bit of a crash track for sprint cars,
right.
you know, compared to, say, Susquehanna, or if Port Royal was having a big race. If we were going to run an extra show, we were going to pick a track, you know, that was just better suited for us. But I don't, you know, we didn't. It's neat that Bob Miller does that. I like, you know, anytime anyone runs a sprint car race and it's not really a sprint car track, but, you know, that's good.
Okay, now, I believe it was Joey Saldana said racing a sprint car at Grandview's like flying a jet plane through a school gymnasium. Was it tough to run a sprint car at Grandview, Don?
It was. Things happen very quick there, you know, and you'd be going. Normally, it's real easy to have your bearings about, but I remember, like, the last time I ran there, which was, you know, still a long time ago, at least 10, 12 years ago, I'm sure. I'm like going down the backstretch, and before I know it, I'm in one and two, and before I even knew that I was through three and four. You know, it happens so quick, and then add traffic into that, naturally, and other cars. You got to really be on your toes there.
Okay, we got a home viewer. Thank you for calling. How can we direct your question?
Rumor has it there's going to be two cars this year at the Tuscarora, one for Donald and one for Lance. Is this true?
No, that is not true. I wish it was. I wish the doctors would release me and I'd be able to race. I really liked running Port Royal, but that's not going to happen. We are retired, and you know, hopefully, maybe sometime at a practice session or something, I'd like to, you know, jump in either Cassidy's car or in Lance's car and just take a couple laps, you know. Just to relive old times.
Okay.
You'd be all right. I've never been out in it.
Thank you. Thank you for your call. When did you actually start, when you were racing, Don, and you had these concussion symptoms, could you actually feel the difference in how you were performing on the racetrack?
I think it was maybe like the week after I was inducted in the Hall of Fame. The next week we went to the Grove and we actually won the feature. And during the feature, I was thinking in the corners, it was fine on the straightaways, but in the corners, that in dirt track racing, you have to see the dirt changes colors.
Right.
And, you know, where it's darker brown, there's more traction there. So I couldn't really see the track when I was up to speed, it changing colors. I could feel it. I could feel the car was better at a certain spot on the track. And I could see the track. It wasn't like it was blurry or anything, but I couldn't see the fine details that you need to see. And I was thinking, darn, I can't believe my eyesight's going like that. So I never even thought anything about a concussion, you know. And then we came back the next week to the Grove, and I ran the whole race. I ran the whole night, and it was really hot out. And after the feature, and I had been exercising and kept myself in pretty good shape while I was racing, and the heat didn't bother me. Well, after the race that night, the heat really bothered me, and I really kind of got sick from it. And I still didn't know why. I didn't know anything about a concussion. Then I came back the following week, and this time on the track, I didn't really notice that much in the heat race, but in the feature, I just was kind of like out of sorts. Like I could tell I wasn't able to keep up with the car, you know, at speed, and I pulled off the track in the feature. Well, that ended up being the last time I was ever on the track. It never got better. You know, it kept getting worse, and I just started seeing doctors, and that was about the beginning of the end.
Okay, wow. Racing's like family, Don. Has your pit crew been there? Many of your members been there the whole time? I mean, I've seen Jerry Christman with you for...
Yeah, he's probably been there the longest now. I don't think, although the guys that I have now have been with me a long time, they have not been there, you know, they weren't there in the beginning.
Right.
Most of these guys did come along in the
Sharman
in the 90s.
Sharman and Landis, I see them all the time when they're...
Yep. John Sharman has been a supporter of mine since 92, 93 and helping on the car. So, and yeah, you said Jerry Christman does the fuel. He's been there.
Yeah, every time I see him, he gives me updates on what Kreitz is doing.
That's good. Yeah, no, we have some faithful supporters.
And, you probably raced against Jerry at Grandview.
I did. Yeah. I did run against Jerry at Grandview, yeah.
Has technology taken the fun out of racing, Don? The idea you can go plug it into a computer and you can do this. Has it taken the fun out of it?
Well, luckily for us in sprint cars, there is technology, and it's mainly just the cost of the engines in sprint cars. But you know, there isn't too much going on with computers in sprint cars. You know, you can't use onboard computers or devices like that of any kind. So it's still, you know, pretty much in the driver's seat.
Okay, your dad was a popular, knowledgeable driver. Does he still tend to give you advice?
Yes. All the time, while I was racing and even while I'm not racing, he gives me advice to give to Lance or, you know, to tell me how to do something on the car. So, yeah, that never ends.
Now, do you have somebody videotaping a race, or do you buy a video of the race to see, you know, how the car's performing in certain parts of the racetrack? Do you look at stuff like that?
Not as often as we should.
I
think that would be very, very smart, and we kind of do go more seat of the pants on our stuff, but you can certainly learn by watching the videos. Every now and then we do, but certainly not enough.
Okay, your daughter Cassidy was a pretty popular and a pretty good race car driver in the slingshot division. She moved over to the 305 sprints. Has she taken to the wing cars like you expected?
Yes. I mean, sprint cars is tough, and you have to manhandle them, and we didn't, kind of more my fault probably than hers, we didn't get her out that much this past year to race, not as often. When you're starting out racing, you need to race a lot. It's just laps and practice, you know. So she only got out 5-6 times to race this year, so hopefully we can get her out a little more next year.
Okay. Now, Is the concept still the same, except the engine's different? Can you still set up her 305 sprint car like you would Lance's 410, or is it a completely different ball game, apples and oranges like?
No, the basics are there. It's basically the exact same car with a smaller engine. So yeah, you use the same setup principles. You do set the car up a little bit different for the less horsepower, but basically it's all the same principle.
Okay, Randy.
Yeah, the actual shop hours. I know with a modified you spend a lot more time because you take the body off and you wash everything and you go. But with the sprint cars, is it as much work involved as it is with the modifieds, or is it an easier, more or less, maintained car?
It's, you don't have the body where you have to straighten. There's still as much work to do, I'm going to say, but it's just that it's not straightening and stuff like on the modified. Yeah,
right.
You end up spending more time on the body, straightening bumpers and rub rails, where on a sprint car, you're not doing that, but you're still working on the car. A sprint car does take a lot of work because it's a lot of horsepower in a car that's a lot lighter than a modified.
Right, right. It's twisting
and
a lot
frame
more.
And all the parts are a lot lighter. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you need to check them. They bounce around more than a modified. They vibrate more. So stuff has a tendency to come loose more. So
you got to check all the nuts and bolts and
you
everything.
You have to check everything very well on a sprint car.
Okay. Are the 358s pricing themselves out of being a regular class? I mean, I heard engine prices for 358s are almost as much as they are for a 410. Are they actually to the point of phasing themselves out, or would it be just be cheaper in the long run for a 358 driver to run a 410?
That's a good question. In some cases, it is for some of the guys to run a 410, and some of them have switched to 410s because 410s pay so much more than 358s. But I would say a top 358 guy that, you know, runs in the top three or four all the time, it's very hard for them to make that transition to a 410 car and get that same amount of money that they were getting in a 358. So they are expensive. There is a lot less of them than what there was at one time, partly because of the 305 division, has stole a lot of the 358 guys.
Okay, we're down to 10 minutes. Home viewer line 610-378-0426. You had a NASCAR career. How did that come about? Why did that go? What was the circumstances involving your NASCAR career?
I always wanted to run NASCAR. You know, when I started out racing, and naturally, you know, everyone has that dreams of doing the big time, and it kind of fell into place when we were lucky enough to win the King's Royal. At the end of that year in 86, we sold all our sprint car stuff and took the winnings from the King's Royal, and we bought a, which is a Xfinity car now, it was a Busch car back then, and they had 30 races on their schedule, and I was one of these guys that was used to racing 100 times a year at the time. So they had 30 races, 22 of them were on short tracks and 8 were on super speedways. So I didn't want to run just 8 times, and I could only afford to buy one car, and you couldn't really run the same car on both the different tracks. So we bought a short track car to run the 22 races, and one thing that I didn't check into, that I didn't understand, I guess, at the time, you'd look in the newspaper, whatever, at the purse breakdown after the races of the, what was the Busch Series back then, and that's not really what the purse, what the, let's just say the cash money, right, or what the actual purse was. That included a lot of contingencies, a lot of point money, show up money from the year before. So the bottom line of this, after I bought the car and got all the stuff that I needed, and when we went to run the races, back at that time, the sprint cars in our area, which were the highest paid in the country, but they were paying $2,000 to win 25 laps. I bought a Busch car to go run these races that were 200 laps, and they were paying $2,000 to win. So, and it was costing a lot more money, naturally, to run that. It was tires and, you know, you needed a pit crew and...
A lot more travel, too.
Yeah, a lot more travel, everything else. The expenses were just through the roof compared to a sprint car. So, we stuck it out for about half a year. We had some really good runs in that car. And then, you know, I seen we weren't going to make it the whole year financially. So, we sold the car. And actually, Jimmy Spencer bought all my stuff. He came to shop and bought everything we had on our Busch car, and we went back to sprint cars.
Plus, with the NASCAR, you practice so much. You time trial, then, you know, you're always out there practicing and practicing.
You're right.
You're running 4 days a week to run one night.
It wasn't near as much fun. You know, sprint car racing spoiled me. You're right. Mm-hmm. You go to a race where they're, you know, 2 or 3 hours, you run the whole show off, you know, you go home. And you're right. In NASCAR, it was practicing. And it just, for me, it wasn't near as much fun as sprint car racing.
Okay, Bristol added dirt to their racetrack. Oswego added dirt for Super Dirt Week. I heard the Bristol race was rather good when they put the dirt on it. Do you see other asphalt tracks possibly putting dirt on to run a special race for a sprint car modified or another class other than what they normally run?
Yeah, I think there's a track did that for the Outlaws this year in the Midwest somewhere.
Oh, really?
I'm not sure. There was somewhere around, you know, Minnesota or Michigan or somewhere around there, there was a track this year that did do that for a World of Outlaws show. So I think, you know, they got a lot of people showing up again for those big races. So I think under the right, you know, circumstances and venue, it obviously must pay for them to do it.
Did you ever run Flemington with a sprint car?
Yeah, I actually won. One there.
Okay.
Was that
completely different with a sprint car compared to?
It's faster.
Yeah.
You know, that's the main thing is it was faster, but you didn't drive it that much different than a modified. I ran them both there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we got a home viewer. Thank you for calling. How can we direct your question?
Donnie mentioned that peanuts are a superstition. Several other drivers mentioned the same thing and were curious why peanuts are superstitious.
I don't know where that started. When I started racing or when my father was racing before I even started, you know, that superstition was already there. So that's a good question. I don't know how far that dates back to, you know, how that ever got started.
Same way with the green. You got to take green. The green to start the race.
I don't know.
You get paid in green. I
don't know where that got started either, the green. I can't really answer that. Not quite that old yet.
Does Lance follow those superstitions?
Lance is not superstitious. He'd show up for, you know, at the races with green on, and I'd be, I'd be flipping out, right? But I'd tell, you know, I'd have to tell him about it, you know, and he's not superstitious at all.
Do you have that where you put, like, your right glove on first and your left glove on, or you have to put your
shoe really. On? I'm not that bad, although I will say, you know, racers or actually anyone in sports, you know, when things are going really good.
You want to do it the same way.
Yes, you don't want to change anything. You know, you got to where you didn't even want to buy a new helmet or you didn't want to change anything. When things are going good, you know, you just leave them go.
Okay, we're down to 5 minutes. I have to ask you this. Your team won one of the World of Outlaws shows, I believe, in June at Williams Grove. Was it just as exciting, you being in victory lane, Don, as the car owner, as it would have been as a driver?
No, you're not. It's going to be second best. Being a car owner, but I don't, you know, it can never really replace the thrill that you get from driving and, you know, doing that yourself, but it's going to be the next best thing.
Okay.
Is Knoxville on your schedule this year, coming up?
No, that's tough. That's tough for us. We don't really have the hauler to do it, and, you know, there's a lot of things. You have to unload out there, you need a pit cart. And the way they do that, we're just not really, you know, our team isn't geared up for that, you know, geared up for making our trips close to, you know, close to home. I wouldn't say it's 100% out of the question, but I would say it's doubtful.
Okay.
Now, we're going to get into some website information. The Speed Shop, if anybody needs parts, is there a email address or a website that they can go to look at the parts at the shop?
KreitzOvalTrack.com is going to be the website, and email is KreitzOvalTrackParts at MSN.com.
Okay, and you have a Facebook page? I know Cassidy's cruising and she's out
yeah,
there.
Yeah, you're asking the wrong question about that.
No Facebook for you? Or send it? No?
Yeah, I don't do any of that stuff. No Facebook, no Twitter for me, but I'm sure we're on it, but you have to talk to my wife or Cassidy about that.
Okay, with your team, and we're coming down to the end here, who does your engines?
Davey Brown. He does them, and he's 82 years old, going to be 83. Does them in a small shop behind his house. Doesn't have a dyno or anything, but he naturally does a fabulous job.
Okay, we have plenty of T-shirt collectors and wearers out there. Do you have any? Is there any team merchandise with either you, Cassidy, or Lance on it for sale?
Cassidy has T-shirts that they can call the shop 610-678-5325 and get them there. And I think Lance has his own website that you can order right off his website and pay for all his merchandise.
Okay, were you ever to the Chili Bowl?
Yes, it's a great thing. Definitely, if you're a big race fan, something to see. Try and put it on your bucket list. It was on mine. I was there. I'm thinking three times or something. And it's a heck of a show.
Yeah, your dad ran midgets and sprints and modifieds and all that. Did you ever want to run a midget at all, or didn't you have any interest in those?
Not really. You know, maybe when they come to a sprint car track or something, but it never really. They were slower, so it didn't really interest me.
Okay.
Okay, we are going to call it quits. We have our 2015. Sprint Car National Sprint Car Hall of Fame enshrinee Don Kreitz Jr. here. They had a fantastic season in the Central Pennsylvania 410 Sprint Car Circuit with driver Lance DeWeese. Many people would like to see Don back in the car. Also, daughter Cassidy will be running the 305 Sprint Cars in the 2017 season. Our December show will be the Fan Forum. I don't know how many people we can cram into this studio, but we're going to have the Fan Forum. It's going to be December the 28th. That'll be from 9 to 10 p.m. I know we're going to have plenty of comments on Facebook. Add something on my page, anywhere you want to put it about the show tonight. But thank you for watching. On behalf of Randy Kane, Don Kreitz Jr., I'm Mike Feltenberger. Thank you and have a good evening.
Hi, my name is Joe Vaccaro Jr., driver of the Mary's Six-Pack and More sponsored number 53 Speedster.
And my name is Joey Vaccaro, driver of the Mary's Six-Pack and More sponsored number 53 Slingshot.
After a long day of work, working at home, or as for us, working on your race cars, there's no better place to stop by than Mary's Six Pack and More for all your adult beverage needs. Mary's Six Pack has over 3,000 different beers in stock and offers a 20% discount on mixed six packs. Mary's also has 14 different beers on tap and offers complete growler service for your fresh beer needs. Also, come in on Sundays for some bench racing with thy bartender, Diane Tobias.
Once again, for all your adult beverage needs, come to Mary's Six Pack and More, 835 Easter Lanes, Reading, PA.